Suzanne Lenhart from the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. She's going to talk about optimal control for management of aquatic population models. So it's like a new subject for us, and I am sure we are going to appreciate it very much. So thank you very much, Suzanne, for accepting to give the talk. So please close your microphones and your video during the transmission.
Okay, so thank you very much for this invitation. I'm glad to be here, and I see a few familiar faces in the on the Zoom. And so I'm gonna be talking about some three examples. And so I'm gonna just, I know a lot of you are involved with control theory. I'll just give you the sort of the approach I'm talking about today. And then I'm gonna talk about a river model. And so basically about populations in a river. And then I'm gonna talk about a Black Sea fishery model that's a little bit more concrete with data from the Black Sea. And then I'm gonna talk about a more theoretical model about where you have the effects of habitat degradation. And so the first paper is collaborator. The first work is collaboration with Rebecca Pettit. She's a former PhD student of mine, and she now works for the US Department of Defense. And then the second paper is with also a former student of mine, who's now currently a fishery postdoc in Michigan State. And Mike Kelly from Transylvania University and Mike Newbert are the collaborators in the last project. And so just to remind you that what we're thinking about here today is thinking about choosing ways to manage a system and choosing some types of terms and to be controlled, source terms or rates to be controlled and manage the system, choose the bounds and the controls and design a goal. And a lot of times when you're designing a goal, you have like a balancing of some trade-offs between opposing factors. And then again, thinking about how we're gonna think about the necessary for conditions for an optimal control. And you would also worry about in general, how to prove existence of an optimal control and perhaps uniqueness. But today I'm just giving sort of an overview of some necessary conditions and some numerical results. And just to remind you that, in one case here today, I'll be talking about ordinary differential equations, but the other cases are partial differential equations. So if you're in the ordinary differential equation case, then you can use Poincaré-Ragland's maximum principle. And in that case, this was developed by Poincaré-Ragland in about 1950. And, the whole idea there is that you're trying to find an optimal control to control a system of ordinary differential equations to maximize an objective functional, but you can convert this to actually looking at what they call a Hamiltonian, to maximize a Hamiltonian with respect to the control. And that Hamiltonian is involved with the integrand of the goal, which would be the objective functional, and the lambda, which is called an adjoint function. Adjoint function attaches the right-hand side of the state ODE or the state system. You would have a whole set of adjoints. And so the adjoints are sort of like Lagrange multipliers that are attaching the constraints to the optimization. And you think about that the adjoints represent how the goal is affected by the states. And so today we're gonna think about that we're gonna choose some actions. So this is like you're coming to a fork in the road and you're choosing actions. And most of these are thought about in connecting to fish. So this is just a funny looking fish there. And so just to tell you my approach, so I'm using this approach using adjoint functions, but sometimes people choose to use other more direct approaches. But basically what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna set up this PDE. I'm gonna have a set of, a control and a particular setup with an objective functional. And I would like to, in general, I would prove the existence of an optimal control in a weak solution space. And then I would work on deriving a necessary condition. So originally if you think about this, you have a control and you would, like to see how this control affects your objective function, your goal. So you would like to differentiate this map. But when you think about differentiating this map, then you understand that the control affects the states, and both the states and the controls are really in this objective functional. So before I can differentiate the map from the control to the objective functional, I have to differentiate the map from the control to the states. So, and that's that in my notation, that derivative of, you know, basically differentiating the state equations through respect to the control is called finding the sensitivity functions. And it's the derivative of that map from the control to the state. And so you will get a linearized PDE in this case for the sensitivities. And then we're going to talk about adjoints. And again, adjoints is really a formal L2 adjoint in terms of you take the look at the sensitivity equation. It's really the formal of the operators in the sensitivity equation. The adjoint is the operators are the formal adjoints of the sensitivity equations. And the adjoint will have a transversality condition, which is a final time condition. And then you remember that the controls, if you start to look at this, think about the non-homogeneous term and the adjoint, and remember that the you want to think about the adjoints as like somehow being driven by how the state affects the goal. So it makes a sense that the integrand, and you take the derivative of the integrand with respect to the state, it makes sense that this is the driver of the adjoint function. And then again, once we sort of get this machine going, where we have this sensitivity system and the adjoint system, we can then differentiate the map and from the control to the objective functional. And once we do that, we usually will get an explicit characterization for the optimal control in terms of the adjoint and the state. Okay, so that's sort of a broad brush, sort of my approach here. Of course, there are other, you know, direct approaches, but this approach I'm talking about today. And so in the first idea here is about populations in rivers. And so I thought I might just help you realize that, you know, a river can be more complicated than you think. And so we just take certain features of the river. Sometimes when you think about a river, it's a mixture of flows and depths. And sometimes you have pools that are deep and slow water, or sometimes you have riffles that are called sort of shallow with fast water, moving water. And then you can also have what's called runs, and runs are like deep with fast water and no turbulence, no fluctuation. So basically people were interested in how populations can survive in rivers and perhaps move in the rivers. So there was some, so this first river example, there were some conjectures by Frischoff Lesher and his in a group was trying to say that a population can persist at any location in a homogeneous habitat if and only if it can evade upstream. So basically, usually a river has like a downstream and upstream because there's some type of flow in a river. And so he was first looking at, you know, flow, but in homogeneous representations of rivers. But then people start to study that, you know, maybe if it's not homogeneous, you can get some interesting things. So that's why they looked at rivers that had this thing, what you call pools and riffles. So basically you want to think about that, you know, for a population to invade, they've got to like sort of be able to, you know, get up to the next pool. They got to like, maybe they got to cross over some riffles and get up to the pools and try to, you know, so maybe they've been, you know, washed downstream and they want to move upstream. And so, so basically people have been studying that and they basically found out that, that, you know, this conjecture is not so simple when you have a river with a lot of different varying features. And really this was Eugen and Mark Lewis and their collaborators doing a lot of work with this, but basically, they want to understand that, you know, you need to have, enough flow. You need to have, you know, if the water high enough so that the populations can actually, you know, move upstream and, you know, get to the next pool. And so basically, you know, the population could get sort of stall and cannot, you know, go any further. So the point is that if you have a homogeneous river, that's a totally separate case than you have a river with different types of sections and different features and non-homogeneous. So they had you, Jen, and their collaborators, so with, you know, so Frank Helker and Steffler and Mark Lewis, they had developed some models for thinking about a heterogeneity, you know, heterogeneous river. So it does, you know, it's got different features. It's heterogeneity and it has fluctuating flows and it's a reaction diffusion model. But basically you're trying to think about, you have a population in this river and the population movement and equations are affected by the river. So you want to, so basically you want to think that this equation is representing a population dynamics, but the terms in it are going to have features of the river because the features of the river affect the population. And what we're trying to do to think about this is that we're going to think about the discharge that's going to control. And so if you try to think about that, so that's going to be an advection term. And so you, if you can control an advection term, you might be able to push the species away from going upstream. And then again, we're now beginning to think about this in terms of invasive carp or zebra mussels in the United States in the lower part of the Mississippi River. And but this today is sort of the more abstract case. Sorry. Okay. So again, to say, make it more clear, we're going to use flow control in this model to keep the invasive species downstream and prevent the population from moving upstream. So here's our model, and you see that if you first of all understand that this is a population density model, so N is the population density, and you see some familiar looking terms. You see that you have your time derivative and you have a diffusion term, and you also have an advection term. But what you see, you have some unusual terms here. In fact, you know, this diffusion term, here's a diffusion term. It has a diffusion coefficient D, but it also has a capital A, which represents a cross-sectional area of the river. So basically the river shape makes a difference. And then if you think about this one here, this is an advection term. And again, Q will be our control. We're controlling this advection coefficient and A is the cross-sectional area. Now there's also an unusual term here. This has to do with what happens when the cross-sectional area changes. So this is a reaction diffusion equation. And this is what you would normally call as logistic growth for the population. So the population is, you know, having less logistic growth, but it's really affected by the changes in the cross-sectional area and how it can move. And so we have in our notation, upstream is called X equal to zero. And so the population is not up there at the upstream when we start this problem. And then, you know, we have this problem, so it's not all the way upstream. And then you see that downstream, we have like a free flow. So we have a N sub X condition equals zero downstream. And then we have an initial condition. And we're just solving this in a weak solution space and all this little zero here with a notation here, just to remind you that it's zero at one end. But again, when we start to think about this problem, Q is the control. And we're having bounded controls. And it's possible that you don't want the lower bound to be zero. Maybe it means in some rivers, you know, even though you might add some flow through the actions of dams or other mechanisms, you might want a small amount of flow at all the time, depending on what you want to do. And then this is our goal, and I'll try to explain the goal. The goal here is to keep the population low, but want to emphasize that you want to keep the population, lower at upstream, that upstream is important. So we put a weight here, and this weight is putting a weight on an emphasis on, you know, when you're minimizing, that it's more important to minimize upstream. And then this is the cost of implementing a control, but we took that relatively small, so it didn't have a big effect. And so just like I was saying earlier, I want to, you know, differentiate these maps. Again, I'm going to, you know, do directional derivatives, and I want to, you know, do the map from the control to the state and get a sensitivity PD, a linear PD. And then I'm also would like to get an adjoint PDE and then, you know, characterize the optimal control and from differentiating the map from the control to the goal. And then I want to show some numerical ones. But today, since I'm showing several examples, I'm just not really showing a lot of the background. So before I even would start on all this, I would prove there exists an optimal control. And you might say, you know, are there some conditions on this in order to get this? There's definitely conditions, because you see that those capital A's, the cross-sectional areas, are in there in very complicated places. So if you go back and think about that, that you really need a lower bound, a strictly positive lower bound. You need bounds on the cross-sectional area. So you don't want the cross-sectional area to be getting close to zero. You also need a bound on the derivative of the cross-sectional area. So you do need some of these basic things to get existence of an optimal process, so this all makes sense. So, and once you sort of have that machinery ready, then you can start doing some a priori estimates and do justify all these steps. Because again, when you want to differentiate this map and justify passing to the limit to get a directional derivative, you would have to, you know, have a priori estimates and convergences. But today we're just sort of showing a few results here, give you an idea of what we're doing. So this is our adjoint PD. And so you can see that this is a backward parabolic equation, but it has a final time condition. And you can see, because of, we still have the zero condition at one end, but the other end has a more complicated condition because it came from a, we had an evective term and we were integrating by parts. So it has a more complicated thing. You might say, well, where'd you get all these terms? These terms came from differentiating the logistic growth. And so that's where these came from. For example, if you think about the logistic growth had an n squared term, you might realize that the when you differentiate that, you're gonna get a 2n times the derivative, the sensitivity. And so this is where you're getting these terms like that. Here's the driver. And so we were talking about this before, that the non-homogeneous term of the adjoint is driven by the effect of the state on the goal. And so that W, you know, if you remember, we had a W times U in our objective functional. So that's the driver, and that's the weight functions, putting the weight at the proper point. And so then once you do these steps, you can actually get an optimal control characterization. And there's a characterization down at the bottom here. So this is our characterization. So, and hopefully it makes sense to you, because again, remember, this is a flow control and an evective term. So when you start to look at this, you can see that this depends on the adjoint, which is sort of telling you how things change with the state. And then this is actually the advection term n sub x. So this representation does indeed make sense, I think. So I wanted to say that I'm doing this with a forward backward sweep method with, and in this problem, we're doing finite differences, and we're doing appropriate upwinding to get the advection terms done correctly. And this is just one approach you can use, but this is the one that's used in this particular thing. And it's an iterative method, solving the state forward in time and the adjoint backward in time, and then update your control using the characterization and sort of maybe averaging with the previous control. But that's the type of method we were using here. And so to talk a little bit more about this, then you would want to look at our initial conditions. So you have to think about that this means that the population is downstream. So we put the population in it in down. And then this weight says we want to emphasize keeping the population away from the upstream. So that's, so you can see these two pieces here. Basically, this is saying the population initially starts downstream, and this is reminding you that in the objective functional, you're keeping the weight high because you want to prevent the population from going upstream. And just to show you a few numerical results today, we have some plots here, and these are plots for just some generic sort of thing, but just showing you here that this is a plot of the population with no control, and hopefully you can tell that this population with no control is larger than the population over here with control, with optimal control. And but the problem with this, it's hard to see how far the river, the population gets downstream in the river. So I'll show that next, but this is to give you an overall thing that somehow we're sort of pushing on the population and keeping the population lower. This is a simple case. This is with a cross-sectional area constant. And so what we wanted to do is try to find a way to show you the cross-sectional area being constant, of course, but showing how the population moves downstream. So we plotted it like this, and hopefully you can see the idea. So this is, if you try to think about this, these are time down here in the bottom, and these are the sort of locations. And so what we did is we took a detection level greater than a half. And so basically when you start off, here's where the populations are near here. They were just here when you just were first starting off. And you see that the red one is no control. And so as time goes on, this population moves all the way down more toward upstream. So it moves toward upstream. And then you see that there's two cases here, the constant control and the optimal control. And actually we do indeed calculate the objective functional values, and you say, well, why wouldn't you just do a constant control? And actually when you show this because of costs and things, you can see there's some difference between doing optimal controls and constant controls. So in terms of the cost, but it just gives you a picture. You can visualize hopefully what this means, you know, where the population is moving, you know, and they're moving like at this time, how far they're moving along the river. And then we also could change the final time. And in this thing, there's lots of parameters to play with and change. If you change the final time to be, you know, going from like 5 to 15, then you see that the population has time to move down the river. So it depends on how you adjust the parameters, of course, but you see that with no control, they have time to move, you know, move along the river. And but if you do optimal control, you can slow them down a bit. We also change various other parameters, and just want to say that when we normally change parameters and calculate the no control objective values, so these are the J values, the constant control, the optimal control, and the improvement. So I just want to show you, you say, well, why don't you just do a constant control the whole time? And basically, if you start looking at the objective function, you can see that the optimal control is a reasonable, you know, it's quite better, much better than the constant control. And so this just gives you some ideas. Sometimes we change carrying capacities or change the natural growth rate. So we did various things, change parameters, even diffusion coefficients and different things. And also, if you would like to look at the controls, here's some graphs just looking at the controls. And these are graphs where we change, again, some parameters. We change the diffusion and change the time. And so what we did is plotted these so you can see them all in the same one. But here's remember the control is actually pushing. So it's a flow control pushing. It pushes on in the invective term. So basically you can see, depending on the diffusion, you might have to, you know, if you had a larger diffusion, you would need to push a lot on the, you know, because the population is going to want to move by diffusion. You'd have to, you know, put a strong flow level to keep it from moving so much. And then, of course, as you change time, if you start to look at this a bit more, as you have the largest amount of time, you still are going to have to do more flow control. You can also do cross-sectional areas, and this is again sort of theoretical work. We're hoping to do something more realistic now, especially with zebra mussels. But this is just an example that if you, you know, take cross-sectional area, you can also do these calculations. And you might ask yourself, I have two cases here. I have a cross-sectional area that's varying in space and time, just a simple example. And then I have a constant one. And you can see that they are different, definitely in terms of the traveling, where the population is traveling along the river. You know, you can definitely look at this, for example, the optimal controls, and try to, you know, look at those. But also the J values, the objective values, are different. One is 60, the one is 66, and the other one's 40. And you might say, well, why is the one with the variable cross section bigger? And it's because actually the cross sectional area of that river is bigger in general. So basically you have the fish has got more area to move. So if you have more area to move, then there'll be more movement of the population. Another thing we frequently thought about sometimes is that, you know, this cross-sectional area, and you know, say you're thinking about cross-sectional area and also thinking about how difficult it might be to implement such a control. And so suppose you had a control that's like this red one that you would like to implement, but maybe that's going to be too hard on a dam or something to try to follow that concrete, you know, that very changing level of flow control. So what we did instead is saying, let's approximate it. And we did some different types of approximation. This is just one to show you an idea, is that once you have this optimal control, you can find an approximate control. So this blue one is like turning on the flow and then turning it off. And again, the approximate control here is this blue one. And it's pretty close to the original one in terms of the objective function, 6% difference. But just to give you an idea, if you think some of these are not very feasible to implement, sometimes we can do good approximations. So this is just a theoretical work in which we've illustrated the whole idea of, you know, pushing an invasive species, you know, fish or mussels, push them, you know, downstream, and keep, you know, illustrating how you can do that. And so we're currently working on data with a different student, working on data on zebra mussels, and hopefully have some new results more about a particular species. And this particular paper has recently, you know, was published last year in the journal Mathematics. So that's the first example. The second example is connecting to anchovy. So this is supposed to be a picture of anchovy. I don't know. It looks a little funny, but anyway, it's a picture of anchovy. And the reason this anchovy came about, because I was had a PhD student from Turkey. And so he was interested in doing fishery models from the Black Sea. And so he was able to get some data for several years about the landing levels. So basically the harvest levels, and also information about the number of vessels and, you know, in terms of like shipping, you know, the fishing ships and all that. So he was able to get all that information. So just to remind you here, we're talking about, so basically we're trying to talk about this Turkish coast here. So I tried to draw a picture here, approximately the Turkish coast of the Black Sea. And so just to remind you that, you know, anchovies are contributing a lot to the global fisheries, and even the Black Sea, if you talk about the fishery in the Black Sea, the anchovy contributes a lot, and of this particular area in the Turkish coast. And it's a seasonal fishery, meaning that it actually is mostly around, you know, September through April. So it's a seasonal fishery. And actually, you even have a smaller fishery time for the commercial fishery, because maybe they want to do it at sort of the time when the fish schools are largest. And the point here is a little bit more about anchovy, that actually there's more like a food web. And so we decided to not look at just anchovies. And so we start thinking about zooplankton, because anchovy is consuming zooplankton. And then we're going to look also at some other species that compete with the anchovy. And so this is some landing data, just to give you some idea. And you can see on this picture that we have, and this is the Black Sea. And so at first you see there's dotted lines, and the dotted line is actually the Turkish landing. And you see that the black line is the total Black Sea landing. And so what you might notice here is that at first they look separate, that the Turkish coast is lower, but what happens is that the fishery on the rest of the part of the Black Sea has sort of collapsed, and now it's basically only happening on the Turkish coast. And there was these collapse had to do with a jellyfish invasion that was, damaging the anchovy. So for a while there was, like, you know, on the northern coast and things, there was a valid, you know, viable anchovy population, but now it's not anymore. It's just pretty much on the southern coast. And what happens is the fish have a migration thing and they sort of, you know, go down to the southern coast and then circle around and come back. So there's a, it's definitely a seasonal type thing. So the idea here was to build a food chain model and think about ways to optimally manage the anchovy on the southern part of the Black Sea. And so we really wanted to see the effects on this fishery, and we wanted to think about a food chain. So we were actually going to put in a predator prey relationships, and we were going to have the jellyfish involved, plus also the plankton involved. And the idea was to think about, we'll have these three populations and we would consider optimal harvesting strategies and compare that with the actual landing in past years. So here's a picture of the consumption in this system. So when I say consumption, so this doesn't show everything, but it just shows that the jellyfish will actually consume anchovies and the jellyfish will consume the plankton and anchovies will consume the plankton. Now we actually have one other term here that it turns out now, after that big crash in more recent years, there actually is another predator that actually is sort of keeping this particular jellyfish in check. So there's another predator out here, and we don't have too much information about this. So we just made a predation term on this jellyfish. And so this is the format of this model. This is an ordinary differential equation system, and there's three logistic growth. So these type of terms here are logistic growth. And just to remind you about logistic growth means that when you're below the carrying capacity, which are the capital Ks, the population will grow up toward the carrying capacity. And then we have some various terms here that are the interaction terms. And so if you start to think about this, you can see that we've got A for anchovy, P for the predator, that is the jellyfish, and Z for the zooplankton. And you see we have some interaction terms. For example, you can see that the interaction between anchovies and zooplankton pulls up the anchovies, and the interaction between the predators and the anchovies pull up this. So basically, these are results of consumption, right? So basically, so you down here have the zooplankton, but you can see that the anchovies are consuming zooplankton, and so are the predators, the jellyfish. But you see here, there's an interaction here. But basically, what you want to see is that the zooplankton help pull up the pea population and the anchovy population. And then this is like a predator-prey relationship here. The jellyfish pull down the anchovies, and so it pulls up the predators, which are the jellyfish. And then you have these two terms in red. One is actually the harvest term. We're only harvesting, in this model, anchovies. And then this is the extra predation term on this predator, the jellyfish. So we have our control is going to be called H here. It's going to be the harvest rate, and we're only going to make it seasonal. So we are not harvesting it everywhere. We know the seasons for that. So basically, when we start to build, it's going to be seasonal, and the control will be turned off in the off season. And so our objective functional here is the following. It's got a discount term. So it's a discounted types of profit. So this is actually the catch, the landing is what they normally would say. And when you start talking about the units here that we actually get for the landing, the units are in tons of fish. And so basically this harvest term times the price, this is the type of what you're going to get. It's going to be the revenue from your harvest, and this is the cost type term. And again, this is not on the whole domain, it's on part of the domain in terms of time, because we're not doing it on the whole time interval, we're doing it on certain intervals in the year. So it's a seasonal thing. So we're trying to think about this as a discount term. So we're thinking about this as like a profit, you know, revenue minus cost. And so this is the overall thing, is your like discounted profit, and you're making a yield. And so we're trying to do a maximization problem, and we're again doing it on seasonality. And then we just, for this one, we can, you know, this is a reasonable optimal control problem for ordinary differential equations. It has existence, things like that. So we're able to use Poincaré's maximum principle, and we directly get the adjoint equations. There's three adjoints, one for each of the populations. And there are, and also here, there are a direct optimal control characterization at the bottom, and that's down here, right? So it's directly optimization there. So this is like you're basically choosing your optimal control using these adjoints, and you get a characterization of the optimal control, and it turns out to be in terms of the anchovies and the corresponding anchovy adjoint function. So just to think about a little bit more about the data here, here's some plots of the anduril landing data. So thinking about this, this is thinking about, and again, this is in types of tons and units of tons. And but what you want to see over the years, the landing is going down. And so we think this is an indication that there's a need for better management. And so we actually, as I said, had landing and fleet data for a good set of years. And we obtained this through government agencies in Turkey. And we needed to estimate some parameters because some things that we didn't know, we did not know the intrinsic growth rates of these populations. We did not, also, we did not know the interaction coefficients. And then you said, well, what if you, you know, think about doing a stability analysis? Say if you just kept a constant harvest and thought, you know, trying to figure out, you don't want to actually make the population of anchovies go to zero. You want to, you know, somehow, you want to keep it at a reasonable level. So so we did a stability analysis with constant harvest, and we were able to use that to figure out what the upper bound should have been on this control. So it gave us an upper bound in the control rate, the harvest rate. And this will just show you one set of solutions here to give you an idea. And so this is actually, if you did what, try to estimate what they were doing currently. And so basically we estimated parameters and what they were doing currently, meaning these past years, what were they doing? And what do you think the populations look like? You can see the populations fluctuate quite a bit. The blue here is the anchovies, and the other two species are much lower. And we'll show you later what the other populations look like. But this is what happens if you do an optimal control strategy, and you get a more regular type of fluctuation for the anchovies. And you also see that the anchovies, what they've been doing recently with this fluctuation, is actually a lower level. And then just to, again, show a little bit more detail, and I just zoomed in here on a smaller number of years so you could see this. This is the anchovies, and this over here is the other two populations, but I blew them up over here so you could see them. Basically, these are the jellyfish and the plankton. Just to give you an idea, again, if you want to think about that, there's some predator prey type relationships here. And so, you know, it's not surprising that these cycle in different ways. And then just to show you what, for this scenario, using this data, what did the optimal controls look like? And they actually are seasonal. So they look like this, right? Give you an idea that they're seasonal. And so just a few months of the year is when they're actually doing it. In fact, then we start to look at this and say, So when you start to look at this, you think, well, maybe this is not reasonable to actually, you know, follow this. It would be a difficult, you know, to get the fisheries to follow this level of rate of harvest. So we approximated it to make it like more, like a bit more simple. And so this is the approximation. And we calculated in this case, the discounted profit in both cases. And basically this approximation, which is probably more feasible to implement, is about within 2% of the optimal goal. So this means this is the goal at the optimal control. So we did approximation here too. Another thing we tried to figure out is, you know, if you're changing the harvest, what's the relationship between and thinking about the number of fleets that you need, and so the effort, how many, you know, the number of fleets you need, and so there's relationships between the amount that you land, and also the this here standing for the catch per unit effort, and so we were able to actually find some relationships between here, basically. So this is actually from the data. You see these dots here are data, and they give you the amount of landing, which is in terms of tons of fish, and they tell you the catch per unit effort. So they can they know how much effort happens, so they can do the catch per unit effort. So we were actually able to fit this, and the reason we were fitting this because we wanted to know what type of effort and catch went with our optimal. So that's, so we use this. This is a regression, a nonlinear regression, between showing a, you know, getting a relationship between landing and catch per unit effort. And the other thing we wanted to talk about was that we used three equations to fit this model and do this analysis. But actually, a lot of times people do fishery models with one equation. And we thought, well, what's the difference if we do this with one equation? So we just took one equation for anchovies, and then we tried to find the optimal harvest for this model. And we also had to refit the parameters because the parameters would be different. There's only a small number of parameters here, the R and the K, but we refit the parameters and with the data. And so what happened, so I show you here. So this is actually on one side. So this side over here is just with one equation only. And this is with the food chain with all three. Now you look at this, you say, well, this looks better that the, you know, anchovies, the blue anchovies look higher, but it turns out they're unrealistic because that one doesn't take into account that the anchovies have these predators out there. And so you might, if you just use one equation, you may get some results, but they're actually unrealistic. And again, we turn out that it's really better to actually try to be a bit more realistic. And so that's what this one has. It has lower levels for anchovies. And again, you can say, well, what about if you calculate the objective functional values? And so basically you're going to, use the landing, the cost, and the net profit. And of course, you know, when you start to look at this, you know, this is my food chain model with my, you know, with my, in this case, my optimal harvest, you know, what levels I got. And then you say, well, what if I did the single species case with, you know, the single species case? And then also you could say, well, what if I took the single species case and I put it in the food chain and did that? So the point is, you say, oh, well, maybe you're going to get more profit if you do the single species case. You might, but it's not actually realistic what's going on. In fact, it's going to overestimate, you know, this model will overestimate your landing because it doesn't correctly estimate the populations. And so it overestimates the landing and the profit. So, and then of course, if you stuck the, you know, put this harvest that came from the seagull species into the food chain, you'll see that you're going to end up lower. So the point is that it seems advantageous to have all three of them. So so I just want to say that just trying to understand that you can, you know, when you use some data and you are able to put in these extra species, you get much better. And then again, we feel like we can give a reliable management information, and we can also have control. And if you want to approximate the controls, you can get controls without much variation. And this paper appeared in a journal, Natural Resource Modeling. So I'm going to talk about one more example pretty briefly. This one's much more theoretical than the Black Sea one, but this one is thinking that, as you know, in many cases when you're harvesting in a habitat, depending on your type of equipment you use, it damages the habitat. So we built a model in which the fishing does harvest, you know, tons of fish, but it also damages the habitat. So we're going to have a model here where you have two things, one equation representing the fish stock and one equation representing the habitat resource. And the remember that the fish depends on the habitat for its, you know, to reproduce. So when we do this, this will again be a parabolic system of partial differential equations. And we're going to have, again, stock and habitat, movement and growth. And then we're going to think about the boundary conditions that in the harvesting. And again, what's going to happen when you harvest? Of course, the harvest is going to lower the level of the fish stock. That makes sense. You're removing fish, but also the harvest will damage, you know, the harvest that, you know, comes from the fishing is going to, you know, damage the habitat. So you'll see that in the next equation. So here are our equations. These are a parabolic system. In this notation, the fish is called U. So that's the fish density is called U. And you see that we have a standard diffusion term and an advection term. We have logistic growth. So this is important to think about logistic growth. In logistic growth, this is R is the intrinsic growth rate, but here is a carrying capacity. And there's a, so what we're saying is we have a basic carrying capacity, but what happens here is that the fish habitat density, so how valuable, you know, the habitat is, how healthy it is, affects, you know, if you affects the carrying capacity. So basically, if you have a bigger K, you're going to get, you know, a bigger carrying capacity, which will help the population grow. So this is a carrying capacity. Again, a fish can usually grow up toward their carrying capacity. And then, so let's talk a little bit more. Here's our control. The control is removing. This is the harvest. Okay, so then we go down here. This is our habitat equation. And again, it has a small amount of diffusion and advection. So a very small amount, the habitat's not moving very much. And it's gonna have a logistic growth here also. But what's important here, it says that the harvest is actually pulling down a small way, but pulling down the habitat. And this is called a habitat sensitivity. So normally when we have this model, we can investigate several things about the values of different parameters, but just show you something to get the quick results here. So so this one, we are trying to, again, a discounted type of profit, but we have here, this is the profit from the harvesting of fish. But here, this is not exactly profit, but it's the idea to think about that you want the habitat to stay healthy. And you might say, can you make any money off that? Sometimes you can, because sometimes if it's a recreational area, if the habitat is healthy, that will make you more money in terms of recreation. This is the cost, again, of doing the harvesting. So, and we're showing just this one case today, meaning that it's an unexploited stock. What I mean by that is the stock is healthy and you are able to harvest it. We have other examples. So that means where you, you know, when you have an initial condition, where do you start out with? And so here's just a comparison here to give you an idea. This is like if you do a model, this model here, and you don't have any habitat connection to show you the difference. So this is over here is the stock, and this is the harvest, the effort. And so this is a without any habitat. You see that this is saying just to, you know, harvest, sometimes you want to not harvest. This is like a reserve here for part of the time you want to not harvest this area, and that will help preserve your profit. So this is a type of a marine reserve, you might say. And then this is just to compare if you want to say, well, maybe it's a bit more realistic, is that you have the fish stock, you have the habitat quality, and then you have the effort. And you can see that if you have the habitat quality, because these are now connected, these two, and you get quite a different effort. You see, when you start to see, you're going to get some, you know, different results. And so it's good to know, thinking about what might happen as time goes on, that, you know, things might change just because of the habitat. And so we looked at different cases of this and tried to see how the goal changes in, you know, different cases about how much the habitat's pulled down and things like that, just to give you different ideas, right? And you can, again think about those. So anyway, this paper appeared in 2018 and really basically, you know, looked at optimal harvesting and when you had a stock and habitat damages. And again, you could get marine reserves there, areas where there's no harvesting happening. And again, you can also think about, you know, keeping the habitat high and see that, you know, if you want the value of the habitat is important, you probably will have even more reserves. And you can look at different types of strategies. So I'm not showing all those today, but the idea is that because you want to save the population, you want to save the habitat. So you don't want to like destroy the habitat and destroy the fish, both don't. So I just want to say that there's lots of other approaches, and I just want to mention that, you know, of course there are some viability modeling approaches that for fishery models, and you might you know, look at Luke Doyne or Pedro Gallardo. And I just also say that a lot of people are now using things about adaptive management and learning to look at fishery models. And we have a group at our university and our institute, which is called NIMBIOS, that was looking at a thing called ecological federalism. And that's sort of like thinking about, you have two areas of where you're going to do some fishing, for example. So you have two areas that are be fish. But the question is, should, you know, one external federal government control both areas, or should the local areas control and just compare the differences? And so that's the thing that we've been doing recently. And also this whole thing of federalism, you know, that's like whether you have a federal government controlling all across, and whether you have local governments having more control. And people are now, of course, studying this in disease models, because, as you know, like in the United States, especially in these times of COVID, the disease controls are very much very local. In fact, sometimes they're even at the county level, not even at the state level. So there's a whole thing about governance things. So, and I just want to point something out in case you're interested in this. We just had an adaptive management tutorial at our institute in Knoxville, the National Institute for Mathematical and Biological Synthesis. And some of these people involved with leaders in adaptive management were there giving that. But actually, there's some amazing recordings. And especially if you want to look at one of these, Mike Springborn gave this amazing talk in which he demonstrated how, not just his, you know, his work, but also cleverness of how he could give teach things with virtually, with using whiteboards and all kinds of things. So you might want to look into that sometime. And so I'm ready to stop and thank you very much and I'll take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So thank you, Suzanne. What's very interesting and at least new for me. do you have any question? If you want, you can open your microphone or raise your hand, please. Marco.
Hi, Susan.
Hello, hi.
Thanks for your talk.
You're welcome.
Yeah, very interesting. I just wanted to ask you whether anything has been done for, let's say, controllability, or that's maybe too much, but stabilization or
I think there's some
analysis of the there. I think you're right. I think with those kind of bilinear control, like in the first example, you
right, discussed. Right, yeah, that all of these are bilinear controls. Actually, I think right. You're absolutely right. I think there's some interesting questions there. So, yeah, maybe we could talk about that sometime. I think there's a lot of open questions for this. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Mm-hmm. All right.
Somebody else.
Okay, I have a question. This is a very particular question. In the third example that you have shown, I didn't understand the meaning of the coefficient PK. You called it PK. Which is the meaning of this?
Well, PK means that if you might have two conflicting things. You might want to harvest the fish. So that's what money you're going to make from harvesting the fish. But this one is, you might want to save the habitat. So this particular thing, we're trying to maximize this. So you want to save the habitat. So it's a playoff between making money off the fish, but you want to save the habitat, because if you let the habitat get too bad, you won't have any fish either. So it's a playoff between these things. So this is like an emphasis on keeping the habitat high. So there's three playoffs here, basically: make some profit, keep the habitat high, and then pay some costs. So there's like a, yeah, some play out there. So yeah. So I actually have results when you, you know, you can take this to be zero if you don't care about the habitat, or you can take this to be, you know, some other constant. And so if you take this to be that the habitat's very important, you won't do as much fishing because it's damaging the habitat. Yeah.
Okay.
Any
other question?
Yes, of course, Mariano.
Yes. Hello. Good afternoon, good morning, and thanks very much for the talk. It was fantastic. And I have a couple of questions.
Okay.
You have said several things that, okay, you obtain an optimal control, and then it's very hard to put that in practice. So you take some approximation with maybe a piecewise constant control
or something like that.
Have you tried to include in your functional some of these, for instance, sparsity promotion norms or these bounded variation norms?
Yeah, actually, I've done that in some cases. So definitely with fishery models, I put in like in these problems I'm showing today, the H function does not necessarily have a derivative, but I've done ones where the H function is like in H1, so it has derivatives and weak derivatives. And so I've done some variation because there are some problems sometimes these particular ones don't have, but sometimes you can get too much variation. And so you want to penalize H. So I've done that somewhat, but I think there's more open problems in that area. And I'm trying to get a postdoc to come that's going to be working on some of these things about adding a penalty for too much variation into the objective functional, and trying to, and that can be kind of tricky for doing numerics. And I've done it like in a particular case, but I'm trying to get a postdoc to work on that more. I think that this postdoc, I don't know if she, this is all gonna work out, but she's currently working with the group with Bill Hager and developing some numerical methods. And so they are actually developing numerical methods to study the whole thing about including the variation as, you know, the low variation in your objective functional. So.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Somebody else? No? So I have, okay, wait, one question maybe. It's not a question, it's a suggestion. With the first model, can you do some kind of hierarchical control and to include a controllability objective? Or have you tried to the-
No, I haven't, that's an issue then.
Level?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. So, so would you try to, that's a possibility, you would have some level you're trying to control the fish to a some level, you know.
Yes.
What you know, what's in this case, well, the first one is not fish, I mean it's fish, but it's invasive species, so you want to drive it you would want to drive it to a low level. Yeah that may, I do think there's a lot of controllability and stabilization. Yeah, I haven't tried, but I think there's a lot of open problems in that. And it's a little bit more complicated because not only do you want it to be low, but you don't want it to be upstream. So you have a double thing, not just low everywhere. You have to like pick your, the target to control to like mostly downstream or something like that probably, yeah. But I haven't tried that, but I mean,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, so maybe that's an interesting open problem.
Yeah, no, I think there's some definitely open problems because it seems like to me that a lot of the controllability results, if you familiar with Leseskia and Trigiani and some of those things, a lot, and their students, they're doing a lot of physical models, you know, and I think there's a lot open in terms of biological models. And so they, and these models are frequently bilinear, as we pointed out, bilinear in the control and state. So, yeah, so I think there's a lot of open things in here. So yeah, if anybody, you know, wants to contact me more about that, I'd be glad. Maybe we can think about some collaboration with those things. Yeah.
Okay, that's perfect. So if there is not any other question, I don't see nobody that wants to ask something. So thank you very much, Suzanne. It was a great talk. And see you next week. We have two young people.
Right, and one of them is my student, so I'll probably...
Yes, so I know.
So if you send me, yeah, I mean, he's doing some preliminary work, so he's just showing what he's starting so far. So, yeah. Okay, well, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Nice to see some of you. Thank you
very much.
You know, I wanted to say that...
Thank you very much.
I wanted to say, since there's somebody here from Chile, you know that... This part of this talk, a lot of this was, I did this at the, there was a Congress on natural resource modeling in Valparaiso last January, and I got to go to that. And so that's one place I saw some people there and talked about some of this. And fortunately, I got to go to Chile before all the COVID hit. So now I was able to travel to Chile. So it was nice.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thanks.